There is that very well-known quote from the Bhagavad Gita, out of 1,000 who seek God, only one finds God. That is, of course, a rather depressing statistic because there are so many who start out sincerely and may nonetheless be a little bit left out at the end. Now, Saranya, I'm delighted that you're doing that. I wonder if we could shift a little so that I can't see you quite as well, because your constant movement and still have the gentleman who needs to see you better. Can you just get off to my peripheral vision a little? Could everybody, like, if you moved off to the side, either where. Yeah, just I can see you too closely. Can you get behind my line of sight? Now everybody's going to see her. She's much more beautiful to watch than me, yeah. Okay, no, I'd rather do that. They can all be distracted, but I can't be. Because if I'm distracted, you have nothing to do, right? Okay. Thank you. Actually, she's a much better show than me, so. All right. So, out of 1,000 who seek, only one finds God. And Master, of course, many of you have heard, when that was presented to him with some, you know, dismay, you get on the path and I'll just say in a moment, when this was said, Master said, quote, our percentage is higher, which was a very interesting statement on many levels to make. And he didn't just say it because the people who were asking were depressed and he was trying to make them feel better. Master never, ever, ever, nor did Swami ever do anything that wasn't absolutely true. Now, my throat's playing its game with me. Cosmic explanation, because otherwise I would have to stop drinking milk in my coffee. So I'd rather say that it's something bigger than that. And then I'm helpless in the face of fate. Swamiji came to Master, I'm talking about Kriyananda and Yogananda. Swamiji came to Master in the last 3.5 years of Master's life when he was orienting himself more toward his departure than toward the building of his work. And with Swamiji, Swami told us that Master often spoke in more impersonal, bigger terms than he had spoken before. He spoke a lot more about himself, Master himself as an avatar, as a realized being. A very good example of this was a case when there was a disciple of Master who asked him a question about a certain saint that had appeared to Master at Encinitas. I believe it might have been Ramakrishna, but I'm not sure. And when the disciple was trying to get Master to answer, Master couldn't remember which saint he might have been talking about. And the disciple was very impressed by that. And Master said, well, so many saints come, meaning people who are no longer living in the body, yet came to Master and would be close to him and converse with him. In terms of Ramakrishna, Master talked about once, he said to Swamiji, that Master was contemplating the life of Ramakrishna, who was an avatar in the 1900s in India. And Master was trying to understand certain aspects of his life, and Ramakrishna materialized in front of him. And Swamiji then said, well, did he explain it to you? And Master said, no, but in the interchange of vibrations, everything was made clear. So Master's talking on a level of his own capacity that's just extremely impressive. So he says to this disciple, who's asking about a certain vision of a certain saint, Master said, where God is, there his devotees come. Now, of course, Master was then equating his own consciousness with God himself. But Master said it in a very matter-of-fact way. There was no sort of great, now I'm really going to tell you something, da-da-da-da-da-dum-dum, like this. He just said it very casually. Where God is, his devotees come. His saints come because they want to be in that company. Master himself talked about being in India and meeting this man of complete realization who was known as Yogi Ramya, and he was a disciple of Ramana Maharshi. And actually, he had become more advanced than his guru. These very strange stories happen. And Master said this fascinating thing. there's a picture of them. He said, I walked with him hand to hand. We held hands and walked around the ashram grounds for a while. He said, if I had spent a half an hour more in his company, I could never have brought myself to leave India again. So here we have Master himself who manifests this infinite consciousness, but when he meets another like himself, the exchange of vibrations, I mean, this is not anything that I could understand, but it's beautiful when you hear it. Master talks also when he, in the autobiography, when he went to the ashram to visit Anandamoyi Ma, and Anandamoyi Ma, and he had this instant recognition. And she was very restrained in her expression, but there's a picture of her with her hand on Master's shoulder, sort of leaning into him like this. And her disciples in all the years had never seen her treat anyone like that. And because there was this instant relationship between them. But Swamiji said when he, later, after Master died, and they were collecting all the sayings and expressions of Master, all the wonderful things he'd said at different times, he offered that story, where God is, his saints come. And the editor of it, who was a disciple, Taramata, who'd been with Master since 1924, Swami came in 1948, so it was quite a long distance differently, she refused to print it the way Swami said it had been put, because she had never heard Master be so grandiose in his expression, and furthermore, in her inappropriate way, she was Master's editor, and she really began to edit him, and she decided he shouldn't have spoken in that particular way. So she said, where a devotee of God comes, there his saints come. And Swamiji would say, in commenting about that terrible editing, he said, I'm a devotee of God. He said, and I really haven't been surrounded by saints in the way that Master, all of us are devotees of God. It completely changes the meaning. But the other side of it, because Swamiji was always so interesting in the way he talked about things, reflecting on it, he said, when Master arrived in America in 1920, Vivekananda had been to America, the one with the big song. What's his name? Ramatirtha had been to America. But I'm not sure if there were any others. Vivekananda was the first Indian guru to come. He was the one who introduced India to America just at the turn of the 1900s. Ramatirtha came a little after that and stayed just for a couple of years. But Yogananda was the first, and then other of Vivekananda's swamis came. But of the stature of Yogananda, he was the first to come. And it was a time when, you know, no internet, no CNN, no capacity as we have now to just have the cultures be so integrated. And when Master first came with his turban and his long hair and his orange clothes, when we were doing the play about Master's disciples, we had Mr. and Mrs. Lewis. Dr. Lewis was a dentist from a small town in Massachusetts. The East Coast can be a lot more narrow than the West Coast. The East Coast in the 20s can be very, very narrow. And Mrs. Lewis talked with some outrage, actually, about this strange character that she saw crossing the open square of their little New England town. I mean, it's just so incredible to think about, dressed all in orange from top to bottom. You know, I'm a person who wears blue all the time, and I joke that I like the summer better than the winter, because in the summer I have a blue dress and I have blue shoes, maybe I have a blue purse. I look like a coordinated person. I don't look like a wacky person. In the winter, you've got blue socks, blue shoes, blue pants, blue sweater, you know, blue hat, blue scarf, and you begin to look a little bizarre. But it's a small thing. That's what Swami wanted of us. I'm happy to do it. But Master, adding to it the exotic and New England, just wandering through, Mrs. Lewis just didn't even want to have anything to do with him. You know, he was a Hindu in their Christian country like this. And so Master just had to start completely from zero. There was a little bit, Walden, Emerson, you know, everybody touched on these things every so often. But nonetheless, what he was bringing was totally unfamiliar. It had nothing to do with what's going on now. And he himself was such an exotic character. He spoke English, but he always had a notable accent to the end of his life. And of course, he was totally unintimidated by anything around him. The mere fact that these were Americans, that it was a materialistic society, it was a necessary condition he had to relate to. But it had nothing to do, it didn't diminish him in any respect at all. He came in above it and then tried to figure out how to relate to it. That's just a moment, I lost a thought there. Just a sec. Oh, yes. And his whole point was not to have himself be this exotic being that had just floated in from somewhere else, but his whole point was to explain to everyone who had the good karma to cross his path that what he brought was a message for them. And that was the most important point about it. He had nothing to gain. He came for no reason at all. He came, I mean, for himself. He had no karma. Jesus described it as no sin. Everyone is born with sin, but I, the Son of God, have no sin, which actually confused people very much about what that meant. But what it was is that we're all compelled to incarnate because we have unresolved experiences, feelings, understandings that have pushed us off of our center attunement with God. And the only way we're going to come back to our center is to participate in this world. We have no choice. We're in the astral world for a time. We're on a little vacation. It's sort of like, now, some people do go settle in Hawaii, but most people go visit Hawaii for a while. A friend of mine, Michael Toms, this was some decades ago, I believe the program is still running, New Dimensions Radio. At that time, it was a very big instrument of the communication of all of these new ideas. And Michael was in the Bay Area, and he decided he would move his entire operation to Hawaii. It seemed more congenial to him. So with great trouble and great expense, he picked up the whole crew and moved the whole thing over there, and you know, started doing his radio program and always worked from there. And then after 6 months, he came back. He said he came back because he knew that if he stayed in Hawaii any longer, he would not only lose all his ambition and forget what he was doing, he wouldn't even remember why he ever wanted to, because the atmosphere was just for him to relax, to, I was going to say manana, but aloha about everything. You know, it's just everything is so beautiful. We'll just eat the coconuts off the trees. Why are we trying to change the world? Why bother? So he picked up and he came back. He had the wherewithal to recognize it. The astral world, which I can't really tell you about, I don't see it. We all have this intuitive memory. I often think of it as kind of like a Hawaii vacation. I know Swamiji said to our friend Linda Gerber, who died maybe even as long as 10 years ago now, Linda had a tremendous sense of beauty above all. She single-handedly used to decorate the whole temple just whenever she had the opportunity to decorate. And she had a very big aura, so this room was about the right size for her, for Christmas, for some of our parties. All by herself, she would do it. And when Swami went to see her toward the very end of her life, I was there and a few others, Swami said to her, "Now, Linda," he said, "you're going to love the astral world." He said, "but don't stay there too long." Just like this, it was sort of like you're going to forget even what you're trying to do, because it's going to be so much fun for you just to manifest anything that you can imagine. You know, so when Master came, let me just try to pull the thread together. Why was I saying all of that? When Master came here, oh yes, he had no, for us, we go to the astral world for a time, because we get to, I think it's nice, we get to rest. We get to be with all our friends. We get to see all our loved ones from all the times. We get to have the satisfaction of manifesting without work. We get a little deeper into what we're supposed to do. Swamiji said once, the reason that we're, the community that we're trying to manifest here, he said, is the same community that we've had in the astral world. That we have the idea in our mind of how beautiful it can be, and we carry it down here, and we try to build temples, and we try to decorate our homes, and we try to create these wonderful astral events because we remember what it was like. In the early years, when I was still living at Ananda Village up in the hills, and everything that we were doing was just beginning. We were just getting to know Swamiji. We were just beginning to understand how appropriately to relate to him and so on. And when his birthday would come around, the idea started forming that we should really celebrate this. In India, actually, only the guru's birthday is celebrated. Nobody else's birthday is considered important. So Master wasn't there, so we were going to celebrate Swamiji. And we didn't have any facilities of any kind in the 70s. And so we used to create these astral realities. There was a place that became known as the Birthday Meadow. And we would just move everything out there and set up a pavilion and serve food and have just this whole thing. We'd move it out in the morning, we'd celebrate Swami's birthday in the afternoon, and then we'd disappear it all and take it home, and it would just go back to being this uninhabited meadow. And I just loved that because it felt so much more appropriate than having some heavy physical thing that lasted. We just took our spirit and our love and we made it happen, and then when it was done, it was just withdrawn. So in whatever way, we live in the astral world for a time, and then we get restless. We get restless because there's these other desires. Just like we move houses and homes and change relationships and change jobs because something is not quite right. Something makes us restless, so we put out energy. We know what that feels like. So we're in the astral world and something makes us restless, and then before you know it, we're a baby again. And Swamiji says the reason the baby cries is because it realizes, oh my goodness, here I am again, and this whole thing, this whole cycle is starting over. We're happy because we know we have to, but there's also this incredible confinement. Just this incredible confinement, and suddenly the body, especially the baby's body, can't do anything at all. It just lies there. You know, it just lies there and waits for somebody to do something with it. You know, I mean, everybody thinks babies are so adorable, but when you think of it from their point of view, it's just somebody has to do something for me. And then there are all these adults hovering around you all the time. You never get any privacy. So it's very paradoxical. But in any case, Master, completely different. You know, there's the entity which is that extraordinary compassion built of his own experience, of the soul's own experience. Master has been through the whole agonizing cycle that we're in the middle of. He's recognized how complex this interplay is between this extraordinary desire for freedom and this weird disinclination to embrace it. And it's Maya. It's the temptress. It's bewitching. It can't be explained by logic. It just simply is. But the masters have been through it. And what they feel from their infinite consciousness, wherever that is, they feel our suffering. Just as simple as that. Whereas we feel our desires and our wants and our likes and our resentments and our revenge and, you know, positive and negative brings us back here. If you're really mad at someone, you will get to be reborn to try to get your vengeance on them. If you're really disappointed, you'll try to come back and be fulfilled. If you're really ashamed, you'll try to come back and make it right. But what the Master feels, because all of that is resolved, he sees our tears. He sees that, oh dear, there they go again. And those relationships, the relationship between your particular Master and yourself, it started who knows when. And our relationships are formed with Master himself, with Lahiri Mahashaya, with Jesus, and then with the disciples of each one of those. Many of us, for me and for many of us, it wasn't really Master who drew me, it was Swami who drew me. Because Swami was attached to Master and he was assigned to take care of me, like this. And we draw each other. I know some of us have drawn our sisters or our brothers or our childhood friends or our mothers or fathers, because it goes in this long pattern. And we start very early with our spiritual family. And we're just gradually drawn into this reality. So Master sees. He doesn't just see in a sort of amorphous sense, oh, there's a kind of a dark cloud down there. He sees you and you and you and you and me. His consciousness being infinite, Swamiji said beautifully that in the infinite consciousness embraces not only the large, but also the minute. In the sparrow, each grain of sand fall not without my sight. This is Master talking about in his poem, Samadhi. You know, the thoughts of all men, but each little tiny part of it is also what it is. And so the Master feels that. And in the Festival of Light, this ritual that we repeat every single week, it has so many threads in it that are just extraordinary. A prayer of love went up from earth and you responded. It says a prayer of love went up from earth. And then all sentient beings, the call, the silent call of unfulfilled love and longing, are human griefs your love alone can mend. And we emanate that, even if we don't know it. Long before we're able to call ourselves disciples and follow the prerequisites and be able to take Kriya initiation, there's just something in us that's longing. And on many occasions, I'm sure you've been the same. If you're sensitively watching things, sometimes you'll see someone will say something unkind but casual, and then you'll see it on another child's face. I mean, another person's face. Well, children, we're all children. When I was working with the costumes for the school play, you know, children are have to be taught about the impact and consequences of their comments. And when we're dressing children for a play that is a little bit exotic, sometimes they put on clothes that are really unusual. And the children, in their uncomfortableness, I mean, the favorite remark, especially among some of the less thoughtful, more unkind children, was, oh, you look weird in that. Weird, somehow that's, you know, to me, weird is kind of a compliment, but to some children, weird is not a compliment, because who wants to be ordinary, really? I'd really rather be weird than be like that. But anyway, that's just the way I was born. But you sort of see, because children are so transparent, you just see this look go across their face. You know, and the child was happy, and then some older child crushes their spirit, and this look goes across their face. And if you're sensitive at all, you just, oh my word. Or sometimes you see it among friends who are close, or unfortunately among husbands and wives who have been together for a long time and then don't notice. Somebody will say something and the other will, you'll just see that look. You know, nothing can be done. It just has to be taken in. There it is. We've all gotten used to this. I myself have a rather sharp tongue, I'll put it in the past tense. And in retrospect, I can see sometimes just some remark like that, and then later I see the look on the face. Oh my goodness, what have I done? You know, countless times happens over and over and over again. And Master feels that. What I was going to say is, long before we know that the answer to that is God realization, we're just caught in this open hurt. And we just become inwardly, we don't even know who we're asking. But we're saying there has to be an answer. And that is so in itself profound, because how do we know there is an answer? We know there is an answer because we know who we are, even though we've forgotten. And we know that somehow this hurt is not how we were made, not who we're destined to be. And so that's the prayer of love that goes up. And it has to be coupled with, I'm willing to change. You know, I'm willing to do something. I was born with yogic samskaras. It's self-evident. It's not a big mystery to look at my life. I was serious on the path by the time I was 19. And I never really did anything else. I just kind of wandered around and stood against the wall and wondered what was going to happen. So it's obvious that I always knew this. And what I knew was just the basics. But I can remember my 1 year of college, and I would try to help people. My problem was I didn't know anything, and it's sort of hard to help people when you're completely ignorant yourself. But I knew a tiny bit more, and there was this characteristic that I observed. I lived in the last year of segregated dorms. After that, everything became integrated, so it was this whole crowd of women together. I made the decision that 18-year-old college women were perhaps the most unhappy demographic I'd ever encountered. But I wasn't doing much better, but I was trying to find out what I needed to do to change myself. And I observed that everyone around me wanted to be happy, but they wanted to be happy by everything. I'm not going to say all of them, but they just wanted everything to be the way they wanted it, and that was what was going to make them happy. It wasn't that, oh, I need to change. You know, I'm holding out this, often at that age, it was this unrequited passion for someone who just simply wasn't interested. But the goal was to try how to get them interested, not how to release what was never going to be a fulfillment. And all of this, inside at a certain point, we begin to know there is an answer, and I'm ready for that answer. And that ripples out. And not only the avatars, but a book falls in your lap, a friend falls in your lap, nowadays a video or something like that. A prayer of love went up from earth and you responded. And so Master came to America as he did, and to go back to where I started with this, Swamiji said it didn't help for him to emphasize his state of realization. In fact, Swamiji said he made it seem like any of you can do this. I realize God, you can realize God. And Swamiji, Master, talked about how much he loved the American spirit. And I love this little part of it. He said in India, where they've known these teachings forever, they're interested in realizing God, but maybe later in some other incarnation. Because, oh, my karma, you know, it's going to be a long time from now. What can I do like this? He said they know how hard it is, so they don't try as hard. In America, he said, because nobody had any idea how difficult this was, and because of our spirit realized God, why, sure, we can do that. And he said, often because of that innocence, in fact, we could, we can, we have. Our percentage is higher, Master said. You know, that's the spirit. So Master himself, Swamiji said, presented himself more like he was just one of the boys. Of course, he could never go that far. But he wanted to create much more of a sense of unity between us. And he said many of his early disciples, of course they revered him, of course they knew who he was, but he deliberately kept an aura like that. And only at the end of his life, and that's why Master said sometimes when he was speaking to Swamiji, write this down, I seldom speak from this level of impersonal wisdom. That's one of the things that Master said to Swami. And Swami even, it was only much later, because of course that was all the experience he had, that he realized why in fact that was true. And much of the difficulty that subsequently happened between Swamiji and his guru bhais was, Swami realized, partly because of that. Because Master himself actually was different for many of the years that they were with him than he was with Swami. And also, the master gives to every disciple exactly what he needs. That true teaching is individual. Now, something's about to happen in this sermon, which happens to me sometimes, but this is a more extreme example. I'm going to go back now and tell you a completely unrelated story. Catherine Kairavi, who lives at Ananda Village, her parents, her father was a clergy person, and her parents were training to be missionaries overseas. I think they never actually went. But there was a very famous man named Frank Laubach who wrote a book called Letters from a Modern Mystic. Absolutely, totally worth reading. Everything that Laubach did was beautiful. And he became that. He was a missionary overseas, and Letters from a Modern Mystic is when he realized in this, wherever he was, I think where there were a lot of Muslims, he was trying to persuade them to be Christians, and nobody wanted to be a Christian. So he tried to figure out how to be useful, and he started teaching the children to read and all sorts of other things. But because he was very alone and didn't have much that was happening, he decided on a moment-by-moment basis to become conscious of the presence of Christ in his life and became a very great saint as a consequence. So all of this, so Laubach comes to the missionary training place where Catherine's parents are, and they ask him to pray. And her parents told her this later. When most people pray, they start. There's a beginning, a middle, and an end, like that. And when Frank Laubach prayed, they said, he simply made audible for a time the continuous conversation he was having inwardly with God. So he would just talk for a while and then stop. So that was sort of the sermon. God bless you.